yeah.
So we cover two things, it's repeated notes, but certainly the pedal. We start with the pedal and we end with the repeated notes.
Yeah, we just mentioned a little bit the pedal in the previous video, but like, yeah.
Okay, everyone, we are still sitting here at the Fritz, and as we were going through some points, having Alberto here sharing his experience, his first time experience with these Viennese fortepianos coming from the modern Steinway, while he's trying to keep Sibyl calm.
We were
briefly touching upon the subject of pedaling. So challenging him to pedal a little bit less, and he challenges me now to pedal even less than I was doing. And so again, we're not going to repeat what we said in the previous video, but very briefly, pedaling is something that no one actually really has figured out. There are so many different options there, so many different composers. Even if you take Janis Pianoforte School, it's a very clear indication what pedaling should be about.
Yeah.
But it's not sure that it applies to a place where Beethoven would not indicate pedal. So what to do in those places? And so Alberto was about to record the third nocturne of Schubert. Mm-hmm. When the pedal, so the sustaining pedal, this mechanism started to make a little noise, so I was lying literally under these Viennese fortepianos. They're famous for making little noises during recording, so I was fixing that. And he was saying, yeah, you know what, we don't know a lot about Schubert's pedaling, which is true. And here it even just indicates pedal, and there is even not an ending. And so I was just saying, like, you know what? Then depress the pedal all the way through and maybe add the moderator too. And he just did that, and then a world opened.
And then we discovered something that, you know, I played the entire impromptu and we never changing the pedal. That means that it was 70 minutes with the pedal down and the moderator down.
Just give a few bars so that and the video will be perhaps up and running now, the impromptu. If it's not, it will come on the channel and we will link it here.
Yeah, so
maybe with without the moderator, and then
let's this will be without moderator, so So the idea is always with the pedal down, and you have this this kind of resonance that then the instrument gives you, and you mix all the harmonies together. So with the moderator, this will be it's a completely new world, and this is what comes up.
I mean, happy that you stopped playing, because it's like, so it's a magical world.
Yeah, we should say that. And when I finished to playing that for the first time, we were like in a state that like none of us could actually believe we couldn't say anything. Like it was
It was almost a clavichord moment.
It was very close, super intimate, super poetic and it's like special. But you know, here in the score, this is actually the only place in this impromptu where Schubert marks pedal, and you know, according to Czerny's school, you are supposed to put a pedal when the composer says to put a pedal, and release when the composer says to release. But here you have pedal, and then never and ever for the entire piece.
Which of course could be a misprint.
It could be a misprint. It could be that like he assumed that there was gonna be a change of pedal at every new harmony, but actually we have no idea.
So yeah, and interesting is also that these fortepiano, still the Erard has that, like this transparency. You can allow yourself to depress a pedal way more on the Erard, but there is one condition that's, and I don't want to relate everything to tempo, but if you're gonna play this like much faster, you will have difficulties for the repeated notes here. They will miss some, and then the harmonic, the harmonic cloud will become like totally intolerable. So you can depress the pedal long time here if the tempo allows. And to just touch upon one thing, I'm going to cover that in a future video because it's important, and you see what the impact of truly understanding historical tempi are. I've read one comment on, someone who really knows about pedaling, like Hummel, he's doing that oftentimes to give pedaling over harmonic changes. And she in that article said, well, obviously that's not possible, but because if you play that in alla breve, it's so fast that everything becomes muddy. So instead of reconstructing the tempo first and then it would work, the implication is the tempo must be very high, and so it doesn't work. So that's an example of
we
that.
We should also specify that for this piece we had a Sturm metronome number, which was a 63, the half note.
For the half note, yes.
So in a metrical reading, there will be like every tick indicates the quarter note. And then you get this kind of speed that allows you to, it gives you time to mix the harmonies. So that means that when you get to the next harmony, the previous one is already fading out. And then it gives like this atmosphere that it's hard to describe, but like it's like the room gets full of sound, and it gets like into your, like in your body, and it just feels so magical.
And it's, you start to understand why this piece lasts so long, because this is one of those Schubert pieces. When I was back in conservatory, I thought, well, does this guy ever stops? Like he keeps on composing, like the piece should last. But now you understand, it's like surprising when you slow down the tempo that much compared to today's mainstream performance, you actually can hold the attention much longer. Like these 17 minutes is like in a magical atmosphere. And you need this length to really immerse you fully, that with the last chord, when the last chord sounds and fades away, you have this like, okay, let's just sit together and don't talk. Just think anymore.
It sounds like it's, nothing can be played after this. And you know, also playing at such speed requires that like you really know like what type, what kind of sound, what kind of articulation you actually need to, like, otherwise it might actually become boring if you don't know like what to do.
That's the
real challenge.
If you hit that line, you know, it's like magic. If you just fall apart left or right, it's like you
it means one beat. Of course there's some sort of flexibility sometimes, because it, the pulse means that like sometimes you go up and sometimes you go down. But if your average speed gets even 2 beats faster or 2 beats slower, you can we saw that in the Fugue of the Wanderer, for example, you need to develop this precise sense of rhythm. And
there happened this one moment where I said something is wrong. And we checked the tempo, it was just two beats up.
Two beats up.
And there was this like friction was not anymore this majestic feeling. But I thought, I mean, this moderator, this thing and the harmonic changes and the pedaling use was worth bringing up, and we should have this disclaimer. We're not saying that this is for sure what Schubert wanted, but what you said to me a few days or a few weeks ago in a WhatsApp message, like, for me, the score from now onwards is like the point of departure.
Yeah.
We are not idiots, so sometimes we will use the pedal because it's like something so obvious.
Of course.
But that's our starting point. We not start to doubt directly what is written down. And in this case, I think that was thanks to your point of view, we did literally what was
there. We did literally, and
And the piano said thank you, because that's what I'm made for this.
Yeah, more than claiming that this is the right way, because of course we will never know unless we find in the future some source that says that. But this is more of an invitation to everyone at home, like, to experiment, because what you might think it's wrong, or what other people might tell you that it's wrong, might actually sound, interesting, and you might discover a word that you will never have thought about.
And that's such an important, let's end this video with that, that call to action. Like, music, it's very much today treated as a museum piece. Like, we have, on one hand, a kind of scientific approach, like, let's try to reconstruct them based on the facts. But on the other hand, it's so wonderful. You cannot experiment with the Rubens painting, but you can with the Schubert piece.
Of course.
And so don't be afraid. And if you like it, there is nothing wrong.
Don't be afraid if other people might not like it. Of course, music, as all arts, is related to the taste as well. So there's nothing wrong when other people might not like the way you conceive a piece, or like, it's totally okay. And the same goes for you with other musicians. So the idea is that we should be open-minded and be ready to experiment and be flexible to change many aspects of who we are, of our technique, as I did. Like, I mean, to record these pieces, I had to change very, very much of my previous way of playing, and there's nothing wrong with that. That doesn't mean that my previous way or style of playing was wrong or was bad, but it was different.
And now we tie into another story, but that's for another video. That's like, what's right or wrong?
Yeah,
there is nothing right or wrong, unless that depends on what perspective you take. But again, we're not gonna touch on this. We were just saying before starting hitting the record button, like, people not are gonna hate us, because we have so much to share. We like to talk, both like to talk. So these videos with us will typically be not very short, but I can imagine that many of you won't mind. So up to the next subject over the coming months, I mean, we will have a lot of things to do. And again, as I said in the previous video, you will see Alberto appear a lot of times, and that's a good thing, I think. That makes this movement, like, really becoming a movement.
Be ready for that.
Okay. I say, stay tuned, subscribe to the channel if you haven't done so already, hit the bell icon so you certainly don't miss when Alberto makes a new video in the future. Who knows how many videos he's going to make. Mm-mm. And then we see each other very soon again. Bye.
Bye-bye.